With all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all of the law and the prophets. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
A reading on transformation. Each of us is formed in the body of Christ and uniquely appropriate to God. So why then, I asked, do we have illness and disease? Years ago, my family was devastated when my brother was diagnosed with cancer. The cancer forced my family down a very dark and painful road. It's times like this when you ask yourself, why? Why did these things happen? Why would God, who loves us so, take us through such dark and troubling times? It's exactly then that I felt so lost and confused that all I could do was turn to God. My dad had recently returned to Emmanuel and started attending church on a regular basis, and since I'm his follower, I like to follow my dad's life, I decided to return to church with him. It was tough being at church in the beginning, week after week, though I started to feel safe here. It was the one day out of the week that I felt safe and calm with everything else that was going on with my brother. I hadn't figured out anything and certainly didn't have any answers to why my brother had to have cancer, but I felt safe and somehow that everything would be okay. Was it a connection with someone or something at church? I'm not sure, but I think my thought was no. It was learning that week after week, God was seeing me through each day, and I needed to trust in Him alone as He was all I had, and that was enough. So last night, I was supposed to speak, and I was asking my husband how he thought I was formed in God. He looked at me, as he usually does, and asked me how I thought I was formed in Christ. I looked at him and I said, I'm not sure. He again looked at me and informed me that I knew the answer to my own question. He continued by saying, my brother's illness formed me in many ways, but my own near passing brought further clarity to me. Yes, I still drive him crazy in the many of the same ways, but he can see through my illness that I have let go of many things, trusting more in what's important in life, how and who I form relationships with, and how I live my daily life. So while I still don't know why we each face varying challenges in life, I do know that Christ is with us in all things and will walk our journey with us, giving us what we need for the journey.
A reading from Ephesians, the second chapter. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what God has made us in Christ Jesus, for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. A couple of weeks ago, I was able to go back for the first time in a year and a half to the last place that I served, to Ocean Park. The poverty team that we started there was celebrating their 5th year anniversary, and I was able to see the quilters and other groups of people from the congregation. We really packed it in 2 days. And it was such a gift. And that evening, a couple came, and their adult son, who's a little bit older than I am, he came with them, and he was still living on the peninsula. And so after dinner, I said to him, hey, why don't we go get some ice cream? I'll take you home. So we went to go get some ice cream. And it was a wonderful experience because we were chatting and he was talking about his life, and I could tell that he felt kind of settled in his own skin. He was working at the grocery store. He felt settled. He wasn't doing construction at the moment, but he was starting to think about, what do I really want to do? What do I really feel called to do in this world? He's in his mid-40s or so. And when I looked at him, I said, you look settled in your skin. He said, yeah, I feel settled in my skin. And I said, do you remember when you first came here? Do you remember when you first came to Ocean Park and to Ocean Park Lutheran Church, what was it, like 4 years ago? Maybe 5 years ago? He said, yeah, I remember. I said, do you remember how angry you were? Yeah, I remember. You remember how you blamed everyone else for your problems? Yeah, I remember that too. Remember how when we were talking, you would say, yeah, yeah, I'm clean. I'm off drugs right now, but you know what? Something's not quite right, and I actually do better on drugs. Like, people think I'm doing better now, but I'm really doing better when I'm on drugs. But he'd stay clean, and then he'd kind of fall away, and then he'd kind of stay clean again, and then he'd kind of fall away. And as we were talking, right, I could see this in him. I could see he would come to church and he'd try to keep it all together, but he wasn't feeling settled in his skin. And then about a couple years after he came to Ocean Park, we talked and he said, yeah, I'm thinking that maybe the drugs aren't good for me. Like, I'm thinking that maybe they're not so good. And now, after 5 years, when he's settled in his skin, he says, no, no, I've been completely free of them for 2 years, solid. And he said, and now I look with new eyes. Now I see how they tore me away from my family, from my daughter, from my life, from who I wanted to be and who I was called to be. And they tore me away from God's love. And they kept tearing at me, and they kept imprisoning me back into the past and all the mistakes I've made and the traumas I've endured. And now he said, I'm ready to live life without them, and I'm ready to start thinking about what God has in store for me now, and not just subsisting every day. That is what it means to be reformed by God's grace. And it takes persistence, and it takes years, and it takes a community. A community that will walk with you. And when you fall away, a community that will drive all over to find you and say, come back. Been there, done that with him. That is why I became, when people ask me, why are you a pastor? That is why I'm a pastor. Because the moment when you start to see the light coming back into somebody's eyes when it has left, when they didn't even remember it ever existed, and you start to see it come back, and it flickers, and it flickers, and then it starts to shine, and then it fades, and then it shines brightly. That is why I'm a pastor. That is the gift of grace that we have here as people of God, as the body of Christ. We get to be a part of wrapping God's arms, our arms, around people and walking with them and watching God through the Holy Spirit and through our love, guided by God, reform people by sheer love. Reformed by God's grace. I thank God that this man is starting a new journey in his life. And I thank God that we are all here, offered the opportunity to be reformed by that same grace each and every day, to hear God's message that you are incredibly valued by God and loved, and you are worth it because God chooses you. And now may the peace of Christ, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in this same Christ Jesus and in this grace, now and always. Amen.
Transformed from Romans 12, 1 and 2. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. I am a retired teacher, although my husband would tell you that once a teacher, always a teacher. I had the opportunity of most of my career to work in special education, and the question that would come up was what's next, especially in high school, what's next? Because schools are entitlement and adult services are eligibility. And I asked that question too, what's next, and kept searching. But I had the opportunity to do a special project my last year teaching, and had six young men that worked down in the county. And I want to tell you about Tom, is not his name. But Tom, we had to interview all the students, and I called the parents and said, yes, this was a my application type thing. Well, he doesn't talk. I said, that's all right, we need to interview him anyway. So we came in and we chatted, and of course we accepted we needed six students, and he was the sixth student. We found that he had many gifts. He would endear himself wherever he went. They did three 11-week internships in the county, and his first internship was at the Dragonfly Cafe. And his mother and father were just really concerned because how is he going to get there? Well, at that time, Mercy One was able to drive him from his, he was in Battleground, to come to the county office, so he got that taken care of. And then, well, he doesn't talk. Well, yeah, he does. His first job was to stamp the bags and do some cleanup. So the first one, you know, teachers have to take data. So the first thing he did stamp 25 pegs in an hour. Now, wasn't that great? No. We needed a little bit more production. But he did. And by the time he finished his 11-week work internship, he was doing over 300 in less than an hour. But he also was cleaning the tables and visiting with all of the people that came in there. They knew him. He knew how to joke with them. And it really made him a part of a community. And so the days went on, and at the end of the year, of course, the goal is to connect them with adult services. And so the family comes in, and actually, let me back up just a little bit. The last week, Mercy One couldn't do the transportation anymore. So what are we going to do? Well, he had chosen an adult vendor, which is what happens when students leave high school and are eligible for services. So they had chosen a vendor, and this vendor then taught him how to ride the bus. Now, this isn't just one bus. This is a bus from Battleground to the mall, transfer and get down to the county office. And by cracky, he showed us all that he knew how to do that. He kept that going, and for the last week then, he rode the bus down there. After that, he was the first of the six students to actually get a job. Dragonfly liked him so well that they hired him. So that meant that he needed to go every day without. He did have support until he actually got the bus thing down. This is such a tremendous story because there are so many he can't. You know, he's not really good with money. He keeps losing things. But if you have purpose, you don't lose things like money and things like that. Well, he had. They still weren't so sure because he always would set his wallet down too. So we're giving these money in various containers. And I think that they finally learned that he could be responsible for a wallet because that was better than these containers that he would lose. But he worked there. He was dear to all the people from the county. And one day I happened to be down there in the summer when he was working, and he was just leaving to catch the bus. However, he had put all of his money that had been in the plastic bag for the bus that would have been for two rides in and out, or into the school work and then out. He put it all in to begin with, which then he had no money. However, God works miracles because I met him there, and he's got there with all of his things, and by now he also had a phone, which, you know, he doesn't talk, he doesn't need a phone. Well, he does have that, and he knows how to use it. He knows how to call mom and things like that. And so I pulled out my money, and you know, the enabling teacher, I gave him money to get on the bus, but then he also gave me the phone so that I could talk to his mother and let him know that he was safe on his way home. And to me, that was the ultimate of my experience of transforming lives, because I had six young men that were now integrated into their communities, and that was wonderful.